I'm in 2 Samuel chapter 5, verse 1. And the title of the message today is Recognizing that God is Involved in My Life. You know, sometimes we can almost go through life and not even be aware or recognize that, hey, God was there. God was doing some things. I can look back at my own life the day I got saved, and I realized that several years before then, I had made some decisions. Like when I was in the seventh grade, I made some decisions that ultimately ended up me being in Alaska when I was 19 and ending up in a church and giving my heart to Jesus. And back then when I was in the seventh grade, I had no idea that God was somehow leading and guiding and directing for the purpose of saving me. You know, back then, I wasn't even aware. I mean, I knew God. I knew of Him. I was in a church. I was raised up in a church, and I knew of Him. But I wasn't aware that He was really intimately involved in my life and dealing with me. And I want you to have that realization for your own life. Even today, you know, we had some exhortations about going through difficult things in life, whether it's suffering or, you know, George didn't have a dad, whatever it might be. You know, God can use those things. And all we have to do is just raise our awareness that God is involved with me. And so many times when things happen in our lives, we say, I wonder why God has left me. I wonder why God has forgotten me. I wonder why God has, you know, tossed me to the side. And He never has. Jesus made this promise to us, I will never leave you and I will never forsake you. How many believe that's true? Then in any situation, His word never means never. I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. So no matter whatever comes into my life, that's what I believe. And that's what I hold to. I will never leave you and I will never forsake you. That's the word of our Lord Jesus Christ. And it's impossible for God to lie. And so if you're here today and you're going through a difficult time and you feel somehow the Lord has forsaken you, reject that idea. It's simply not true. And so today we're going to look at the life of David and we're going to just see different ways that God was involved in his life and maybe learn some truths that will help us. So in 2 Samuel chapter 5, verse 1, all the tribes of Israel came to David at Hebron and said, "Behold, we are your bone and flesh. In time past, when Saul was king over us, it was you who led out and brought in Israel." Now, if you remember in the earlier chapters of this book, the people who were the tribes of Israel, who we're talking about here, the tribes of Israel had rejected David as their king. Remember, Judah anointed him as king, but Israel rejected him, and they made Mephibosheth their king. I mean, Ishbosheth their king. But now, some years later, all those tribes are coming. The ones who rejected him are now coming and saying, "We are your bone and your flesh. In time past, when Saul was king, it was really you." Now, David was the one who led the armies of Israel. He was the captain of the army of the Lord there in Israel. "It was you who led us out. It was you who brought us in." And look what it says here. "And the Lord said to you," and the Lord said to you, "You shall be shepherd of my people Israel." See, the Lord had spoken to David earlier on in his life. He told him two things. "You will be shepherd of my people Israel, and you will be prince over Israel." Well, until this day, that didn't happen. And before this day, you know that David went through all those struggles where Saul was trying to kill him, and Saul was trying to defeat him, and Saul was trying to put an end to his life because he was jealous of him. And yet the Lord had spoken to David years earlier, "You will be the shepherd of my people Israel, and you will be prince over Israel." Have you ever had a promise that you feel God has spoken to you and it just never came to be? And you keep wondering, "Lord, is it ever going to happen? Is it ever going to happen?" Well, maybe it'll take years. Maybe it will. And maybe you'll have to go through hardships along the way. But if the Lord has promised you something, He's going to fulfill it. And so the first thing I want you to understand about God's involvement in your life is he does have a plan for you. I mean, to me, that is one of the most foundational concepts that if you can grasp as a believer in Christ, that God has a plan for your life, it'll change the way you live. It'll change the things you pray for. It'll change the decisions that you make. God has a plan for you. I believe, just like he spoke to Jeremiah back in the book of Jeremiah chapter 1, before you were in your mother's womb, I knew you, he said. And I called you to be a prophet of the nations. Can you imagine that God knew you before you were in your mother's womb? He did. Before you were there, he knew you. And along with that, he has a plan and a purpose for your life. I wonder what that is. I've said this before, and I want to encourage parents again. Rather than tell your children you can be anything you want to be, tell your children you can be whatever the Lord wants you to be. Because the Lord has a plan for their life. When we look at these children who are out here in Sunday school and in the nursery and you're having children or whatever children come our way that we have the ability to influence, remember God has a plan for them. And that little boy that becomes a terror running through the church building and he's got shoe marks all over the walls and tearing down doors and whatever they do, God has a purpose for that boy. I was at one time that boy. And I know, I was that boy. But the Lord has a purpose for our lives. And David had a purpose. Did he go through struggle? Absolutely. Did he go through hardship? Yes. Many, many struggles. And yet on this day, all those tribes of Israel said, David, we are your bone and your flesh. You will be our king. And what the Lord had spoken to him years ago finally came to pass. God has a purpose for your life. Number two, look at verse 3. All the elders of Israel came to the king at Hebron, and David made a covenant with them at Hebron before the Lord. This word, before the Lord, if you look up the Hebrew language, it means in front of his face. And I wrote down on my notes here, as far as a point out of this particular scripture, is that my life is lived out in front of God. My life is lived out before the face of God. Think about that. Nothing is hidden from him. You know, if we go to the uttermost parts of the earth, he is there. If we go to the place of darkness, it's like light to him. Nothing is hidden from the Lord. And we live our lives out in front of his face. Now, let me ask you this question. If the Lord was walking with you, physically walking with you every day, you got up in the morning, he's there. What would you do? What would you say to your children? How would you treat your wife or your husband? What would you do at work if you walked down there and here's Jesus right here with me? Well, he is. He really is. Everywhere we go, he's with us. We are living our life out in the face of Jesus before the Lord. David made a covenant, but it wasn't an idle covenant. It wasn't an idle promise. I will be your king. I will be your prince. He made this before the Lord. He made a promise in the face of God. And when we start living our lives like this, recognizing that everything I do is in the face of God, I believe it will change how we live. It will change how we forgive. It will change how we love. It will change how we're willing to show mercy. Everything is in the face of Jesus. And because we don't see him with our physical eyes, it's almost like out of sight, out of mind. But why don't we just say, Lord, help me to be reminded of this every day of my life, that I'm living my life before the face of God. That's what David did here. He made a covenant with them before the Lord, and they anointed David as king. David was 30 years old when he began to reign. He reigned 40 years. Hebron, he reigned over Judah for 7 years and 6 months, and at Jerusalem, he reigned over all of Israel for 33 years. The scripture in Proverbs 15:3 says this, "The eyes of the Lord are everywhere." We used to tell our children that when they were little. This is how we kept them in line. The eyes of the Lord, and we used the King James Version at the time. We said, "The eyes of the Lord are in every place, beholding the evil and the good." We wanted them to be aware that you are living your life in the face of God. The eyes of the Lord are everywhere. Even when you're alone, the eyes of the Lord are there. Keeping watch on the wicked and the good. So how do you approach living life before the Lord? One is you can do like this scripture says and just accept the idea that God sees everything. How many would you say believe that, that God sees everything? I think that's unanimous. Or here's another way, an additional way. Colossians 3:17 says, "Whatever you do, whether word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him." So you can just kind of say by default, I know that God is everywhere and just continue with your life. Or you can be more intentional and say, because I know he sees me, I'm going to live differently. I want to live because I want to please him. I want to put a smile on his face. I'm living my life in the face of God. And Lord Jesus, I want to, whatever I do in word or deed, I want to do it all in your name. Everything I do, all my actions, all the words that I speak, even my thoughts, Lord, you know, sanctify them. Let me think well of my brother. Let me speak well of my brother. And I want to live my life in the face of God. God is involved in your life. Next, read in, I guess we'll go down to verse 6. King and his men went to Jerusalem against the Jebusites, the inhabitants of the land. Now, before this happened, remember back in the days when Joshua was taking the children into the promised land? He told them to drive out the inhabitants. Well, they didn't really drive out the Jebusites. The Jebusites were one group that was left behind. And they happened to be living in Jerusalem. And the Bible does tell us, I have these, I'm not going to read these scriptures, but I'll give them to you if you want to write them down. In 2 Chronicles 6:6, it says, God says this, "I have chosen Jerusalem for my name to be there." See, Jerusalem was his place. "I've chosen Jerusalem that my name might be there." Well, at this point, his name wasn't there. The Jebusites were there. And in Judges chapter 1, verse 21, we see where it says the Benjamites were unable to extract the Jebusites. So they were left in the land. Well, now David's the king, and whether he realized that the Lord wanted Jerusalem for himself or not, or whether he was just wanting to drive out all the inhabitants that were there, he wanted to go take Jerusalem. And there's a great scripture. Maybe you turn here. I'll read this. This is really part of what I want to say here. It's in Judges chapter 3, verse 1. Judges chapter 3, verse 1. "These are the nations the Lord left to test to what? To test. These are the nations the Lord left to test all those Israelites who had not experienced any of the wars in Canaan." I believe this. I believe that God wants us to be warriors. We're called to fight. We are called to fight the good fight of faith. We're not picking up physical weapons. The weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they are mighty through the pulling down of strongholds. God wants us to be warriors in his kingdom. I think one of the reasons why we see so many Christians who never get to victory, they're not willing to fight. They're not willing to stand up and do battle. Somehow we take it lying down. It's like, oh, I can't deal with this. It's too much for me. He wants us to be warriors. And so the Lord says, I want you to know one thing I did. I left some people here because I want to test people who've never experienced war. I want them to learn how to fight. And I wonder if the Lord, even today, allows testing into our lives because he's teaching us to war. He's teaching us to fight. He's teaching us to deal with things in our life, to cast down imaginations and strongholds and everything that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. Wouldn't it be great if you could stand up and say on a testimony here, I want you to know that this came into my life and the Lord used me to fight against it and I have victory in Jesus. Rather than, I can't get a handle on my life. My life's falling apart. I can't get up. I can't, you know what I mean? He's called us to fight. And so back then, he left some people there for the purpose that we would experience or they would experience war. Verse 2, he did this only to teach warfare to the descendants of the Israelites who had not had previous battle experience. How many of you, isn't that a neat scripture? It shows you the heart of God. That he wants us to do battle. The five rulers of the Philistines. So when you read about the Philistines always coming against Israel and Samson, the Lord left them there. He left them there so we would learn to fight. All the Canaanites, the Sidonians, the Hivites living in Lebanon, mountains from Mount Baal Hermon to Lebo Hamath. There's a great name for a kid right there. They were left to test the Israelites to see whether they would obey the Lord's commands. What are you going to do on the day of battle? See, they're left there to test the Israelites to see whether they will obey, which he had given their ancestors through Moses. The Israelites lived among the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Amorites, the Perizzites, the Hivites, and the Jebusites. And that's who we're talking about today. The Jebusites were there in Jerusalem, and David, you know what? David came to fight. David was a warrior. And so he says the king and his men went to Jerusalem. I'm back now in 2 Samuel chapter 5, verse 6. He went to Jerusalem against the Jebusites, the inhabitants of the land, who said to David, you will not come in here, but the blind and the lame will ward you off, thinking David cannot come in here. So what's happening here? You're having this enemy taunt David. Jerusalem was a great place to be because it was so easily defended in terms of its geography. And these Jebusites were in there thinking, there's no way that you can take this city. And so they're taunting him. I mean, they weren't really sending out, I don't believe, blind and lame people, but they were basically saying, look, if you try to come against us, we could put out here the blind and the lame, and they would defeat you. You know what happens? Satan tells us that very thing. We believe him. He taunts us. You'll never come in here. You'll never take this city. You're too weak. If you come against us, I'm going to give my weakest out there, and he will overcome you. And we run and cower. But I love David. It says, nevertheless, I love that word here, David took the stronghold of Zion. Now, you don't really have it here, but there's a parallel scripture, and I can't remember if it's I think it's in 2 Chronicles, a parallel scripture of this, that David said to his men, anybody who wants to be the captain of the army, go up first. What is that? That's a warrior spirit. You want to be the captain? Take us in. Joab says, I'm in. He jumps in there, and they had this like a water shaft that would come out. They went through that water shaft and went in there and took the city. David was a warrior. David took the stronghold, that is the city of David. And David said on that day, whoever would strike the Jebusites, let him get up the water shaft to attack the lame and the blind, who are hated by David's soul. Now, David didn't hate lame and blind people, but I believe what he hated was that thing which is taunting him. They said, oh, the weakest thing can overcome you, David. And David says, I hate that thing. We have to learn to hate the thing that Satan uses to taunt us. You are unworthy. You never had a dad. Your mother abused you. All your friends said evil things. They threw rocks and stones at you. Look at your life. Look how ugly you are. Look how this or that. You know, whatever it is he says, we have to learn to hate that thing and fight it. Like I say, we take it laying down. Oh, I guess I am weak. I guess I am unlovely. I guess I didn't have a dad. I guess I didn't have. And so we sit down in defeat. But the army of the Lord says, no, I'm going to rise up because this is territory the Lord wants us to take. He wants us to have victory in our life. And David was that warrior. And so it says, the blind and the lame shall not come into this house. David lived in the stronghold and called it the city of David. And David built the city all around from the Milo inward. Verse 10. David became greater and greater, for the Lord God of hosts was with him. Hiram, king of Tyre, sent messengers to David, and cedar trees, and carpenters and masons who built David a house. What would you do if you were the king of Israel, and all of a sudden, this other king comes over and says, hey, I'm going to build you a house. Here's some cedar, here's everything you need. I'm going to build you this great house. What would happen in your heart? I wonder if you would think you were something. Like, hey, wow, look at me, man. This other king's coming here to build me a house. I must be really famous. My name must be getting out there. I must be amazing. Because now other people are coming and saying, hey, we want to honor you with this house, David. Not David. The Bible says in verse 10, David became greater and greater, not because David was some great one. It's because the Lord was with him. You can never, ever forget this. You will become greater and greater because the Lord is with you. It is the Lord who raised him up. It is the Lord who sustained him. It is the Lord who gave him these victories. And whenever God begins to raise you up and use you and see great victories in your life, never forget it's because of the Lord who is with us. That's the only thing that gives us victory. Jesus said, apart from me, you can do nothing. And this king of Tyre came, brought the cedar trees, as I said. Verse 12, David knew that the Lord had established him as king. See, what David sat back and thought about was not how great I am. He said, now I know the Lord has established me. See, everything was turned to the Lord. He had exalted this kingdom. And then that last thing it says here, he did it for the sake of his people. You know, God didn't raise up David for the sake of David. He didn't exalt his kingdom for the sake of David. He did it for the sake of his people. And so what I wrote down here is a point. God's involvement in my life serves his greater purpose. If God wants to use me in any capacity, it's for his greater purpose. If God wants to use you, it's for his greater purpose. And so there's no need for us to come down and think we have all this pride because, oh, look how God used me. It is for his purpose. I wonder what part of God's purpose will be touched by me being faithful to come and prophesy, or by me going out and sharing the gospel with my friend at work or my neighbor. It's God's greater purpose. And David realized that it was the Lord who made him king. It is him who exalted his kingdom, and he did it for the sake of his people. We sometimes think too highly of ourselves, and we need to realize that God using me and God using me to raise me up or stirring up spiritual gifts in my life or whatever it is that's God's purpose for me, it's really for his greater purpose. And that should cause a great humility to come upon our heart, brothers and sisters. Verse 13, David took more concubines and wives from Jerusalem. after he came from Hebron, and more sons and daughters were born to David. These are the names of those who were born to him in Jerusalem. Shammua, there's a great name. Shammua, Shobab, Nathan, Solomon, Obhar, Elishua, Nepheg, Japhia, Elishama, Eliada, Eliphelet. In the Bible, David has eight wives that are named, eight. How many of you know that that's really what brought David most of his problems is his family situation? How many have found that one is enough? He had 20 children who were named, 20 that were named. But you know, this is in direct violation of the Word of God. The Bible says in Deuteronomy 17, when the Lord is raising up a king, he says, he must not take many wives, or his heart will be led astray. So what's my point? The Lord still used him. Now, I'm not saying that to be an excuse for sin. It was wrong what David did. But see, here's what happens in our life. We fail the Lord. We sin. Something happens in your life, and you all of a sudden, it's like, he'll never use me ever again. But you got to remember, God has a purpose for your life. God has a plan for your life. And even though we have failings in our life, he can still do something within us. I just wrote on my notes here, this is an encouragement to not let your sin or failure be an excuse to stop pursuing God. Pursue God. Repent of the sin that's there. Get your heart right, but don't stop pursuing him. Be the warrior. I wonder how many of God's people who have been called for a purpose in God's kingdom, in their life, a purpose or a plan, have now sat on the sidelines because somehow they failed the Lord. Oh, I've done this, God will never use me. I said that, God can never use me. This will happen in my life, God will never use me. And I just don't see that in the Word of God. And again, I'm not saying, and I'm not making excuses for sin, and I'm not saying to be blasé about that. All I'm saying is, even in that, when we repent, God forgives us, he restores us back into righteousness, he says, get back up and do my work. When Peter denied the Lord three times, and Jesus came to him and said, who do you love? Do you love me? Yes, then if you do, do the thing I've called you for. I've called you to be a leader of my people, to be a rock. And so if you love me, feed my sheep. If you love me, feed my lambs. Don't be out here fishing for fish. Don't be out here wallowing in the mire because you failed me. Get back on track. This is your purpose. This is why you have been made. And maybe some of us need to do that kind of prayer with the Lord. Lord, I feel like I failed. My life has been on the sidelines. I want to change that. I want to get back up again on my feet and do what you've called me to do. And finally, in verse 17, when the Philistines heard that David had been anointed king over Israel, all the Philistines went up to search for David. David heard of it. He went down to the stronghold. He went down into Jerusalem. Now, the Philistines had come and spread out in a valley of Rephaim. And David inquired of the Lord. That's so important. Shall I go up against the Philistines? Will you give them to my hand? And the Lord said to David, go up, for I will certainly give the Philistines into your hand. And David came to Baal-perazim, and David defeated them there, and he said, the Lord has broken through my enemies before me like a breaking flood. Therefore, the name of that place is called Baal-perazim. What a great victory. Now, what about verse 21? The Philistines left their idols there, and David and his men carried them away, and the Philistines came up yet again. So now we had in the earlier verses, the Philistines came against David, and they spread out in the valley of Rephaim, and now again the Philistines are coming up, and they're spreading out again in the valley of Rephaim. Wouldn't you think, like, hey, we did it once, let's do it again? But I want to say to you, don't rely on past answers from the Lord to answer today's problems. Everything is different this time around. And David inquired of the Lord. What a wise man. It looked like everything was exactly the same. It was the same Philistines. It was the same valley coming against the same army of Israel. But it was a different strategy this time. It was a different way. And the only way David would have known is if he inquired of the Lord. And so he inquired of the Lord, and the Lord said, "You shall not go up. Go around to the rear and come against them opposite the balsam trees. And when you hear the sound of marching in the tops of the trees, then rouse yourself, for then the Lord has gone out before you to strike down the army of Israel." You know, the thing that we love, I'm going to tell you this, I know it's true, I've seen it in my life, and I've talked to so many people, we love patterns. We want to have God, well, if I hold my hand a certain way and pray a certain prayer, God's bound to answer. Because I know the last time we prayed for a healing, and I was standing right here holding my hand like this, and I was on their shoulder, and I said these words. So the next time somebody comes up with prayer, hey, let's do that same thing again. It's different. Everything is different. The Lord wants us to learn to rely upon Him, that we don't build our lives on past successes. Because you cannot put the Lord in a box. Look how Jesus healed people. He spit on the ground and made mud and stuffed it in the guy's eye. How many have ever done that before? Maybe the Lord wants you to do that sometime. Maybe we ought to have a box of dirt up here just in case. You know what I mean? But I think the Lord did that to show us there is no pattern here. Because if we can get God into a pattern, then we're going to have success every time. But the Lord doesn't work by patterns. He does what He wants to do. And it's up to us to seek Him, to hear His voice, and be led His way. And so, because God has a purpose for our lives, let's learn to inquire of Him. Let's be people of prayer. Let's seek Him about every circumstance and not try to put God into a pattern that we feel more comfortable with. He just wants us to seek Him. And then finally, you can stand with me in verse 25. David did as the Lord commanded, and he struck down the Philistines. At the end of the day, God's purpose being fulfilled in our life is linked to obedience. You know, David inquired of the Lord, "Shall I go up against the Philistines?" Yes. Second time he inquired, "No, do it differently." But David had success because he listened. He heard what the Lord said and he obeyed it. God has a purpose for your life, brothers and sisters, every one of us. Sometimes we go through struggles like David, and yet He will still fulfill His purpose for us. Sometimes we disobey the Lord. He'll still work with us. He has a purpose for our life. Be a person who's a seeker of God, an inquirer of God, and don't look for trying to put Him in some kind of a box that makes you comfortable. Seek Him in every circumstance. But at the end of the day, you got to do what He wants you to do. It's obedience. You know, my God's purpose in my life was for me to be a pastor, but you know what? I had to respond to that. I had to respond to it. I had to obey and say, "Yes, Lord." What is it that God wants for you? Are you willing to say, "Yes, Lord"?